Hi.
Is he right there?
Sound check, can you hear me out there?
Yes.
I'm thinking this much.
That's right.
Please come to order. Regular meeting in the town of Quartzsite Common Council for Tuesday, December 14th, 2021, is now in session. Do we have a member of the audience wishing to give the invocation? Seeing none, please stand. We'll have council member in, give the invocation, followed by council member Shu leading us in the pledge of allegiance.
Throughout this season of Thanksgiving and holy traditions of our families, we have seen the goodness of man always at the forefront, an innate urge to help and foster good feeling about community. Look for it, identify it, and celebrate daily the goodness of man every time we see it and determine to foster it in ourselves. We are so blessed. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pledge to our flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Play ball. Please call the roll.
Mayor Simpson.
Here.
Vice Mayor Warner.
Here.
Councilmember Bearcat.
Present.
Councilmember Shu.
Here.
Councilmember Goldberg.
Here.
Councilmember Anna.
Present.
First item, roll call. Item number one, call to the public. Announcement and communication from citizens. At this time, members of the public may comment on matters within the jurisdiction of the town and matters designated for no public comment. Comments on matters on the agenda designated for public comment are to be made at the time the council considers the item. For the official record, individuals must state their name. There is a 3-minute limit for each speaker. The council's response is limited to responding to criticism, asking staff to review a matter commented upon, or asking that a matter be placed on a future agenda if the matter is not already on the agenda. If the matter is on the agenda, the council may respond, but discussions will be reserved until the matter is introduced on the agenda. Yeah.
Lynn Simpson?
Good evening, council, and people who have chosen to show up tonight. I'm speaking for the Quartzsite Historical Society and the Tyson Wells Stage Station Museum. We've had a lot going on this year, but in January we have a special event On January 9th at 7 p.m., we're going to show the High Jolly movie again. It will be at the QIA, and it's $7 at the door, and we'll have tickets at the museum and at the High Jolly Daze Parade. And I just want to hope everybody supports it. It ended up being a great success last time because it was free and it was the end of February. We had 600 people there. If we get less than that, we won't be upset. But it is a wonderful documentary, and I think everybody should see it. And we have DVDs for sale of the movie if you want to send it as a late Christmas present to maybe shut-ins or somebody in your family. And I just want to invite the council and everybody attending tonight to this movie on January 9th. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, let's know no one else for a call to the public. We'll put a call to the public and move on to public hearing. If no request to speak have been submitted, items will be heard at one public hearing. Items may be heard separately if requested by a member of the council or if a request to speak has been submitted. Comments will be heard from those in support of or in opposition to an item. There is a 3-minute limit for each speaker. Once the hearing is closed, there will be no further public comment unless requested by a member of the council. After the public hearing, the council may act on all items not requiring additional staff, public, or council member comment with a single vote. Item number 2 is the public hearing on the liquor license application. Consideration of possible recommendation of approval of the Arizona Department of Liquor License and Control application for a Series 6 liquor license bar for the Quartzsite Yacht Club located at 1090 West Main, Quartzsite, Arizona. And the second item is the public hearing on Camel Express Transit Grant application. Discussion and consideration regarding the authorization of the Transit Department to apply for federal financial assistance to provide public transportation for the federal fiscal year 2022-2023. Okay, this is a public hearing. Item 2, is there a liquor license application?
Yes, sir. Good evening, Mayor and Town Council. I forfeited my restaurant license in July and acquired a Series 6 so I could become a full-service bar. So that's why I applied and hoping that you'll approve it and I can continue serving our community.
Okay. Introduce yourself.
Oh, I apologize. My name is Melba Selig. I run the Quartzsite Yacht Club, a restaurant and bar, and I've been there about 7 years now. And I'm hoping that you'll approve my license so I can continue.
Okay. Anyone else wish to speak on this item? Okay, please come on.
I would say go ahead and approve it, and I just want to say to the owner, I like your food. I like your food.
Just please address your comments to the
okay,
council.
I'm sorry.
It's not appropriate to address the
sorry.
The public. Sorry.
Anyway, I'd say go for it.
And your name for
the public. Oh, sorry. Jandy Janelle.
Anyone else wish to speak on this item? Okay, we'll close public hearing on item 2 and go to public hearing on number 3, the public hearing on the Camel Express Transit Grant application.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Ann Collier, Transit Department. What you guys have to the comments of...
Jan, you can get a little bit. There you go.
What you have is a copy of the public notice announcing our public meeting and our public hearing and letting everyone know that they have the right to ask questions, make comments, seek information, that kind of thing. So our public hearing will open tonight and will close on January the 11th, giving everybody who wishes ample time to have input.
Anyone else wish to speak on this item? Okay. That's the process when it's announced that the public hearing for that item will be continued on for 7 more days. Just to let them know that the public hearing will continue on for 3 days.
It's open for written comment. The notice went out, and in there it indicates that, but you can state that as well, you know, it will be open for written comment for the next 30 days. The other one is closed tonight.
Okay, seeing no one else is interested in speaking on item 3, we'll close the public hearing. Going to item number 4.
Are we closing the public hearing or are we extending?
We're closing the public hearing for number 2. The public hearing for number 3 remains open for written comment for the next 30 days.
Thank you. Item number 4, consent agenda. Consent agenda is a list of items believed to be non-controversial. All items will be acted upon with one motion. And any council member may have an item removed for separate discussion and action. Item 4A, ledger of accounts paid. Consider approval of accounts payable check series number 49031 through 49050. Numbers 49060 through 49080, totaling $473,654.32. And payroll check series paid, number 49021 through 49030, totaling $82,475.25. And series 49051 through 49059, totaling $90,037.11, for a grand total of $646,166.68. Item 4B, the minutes. Consider approval of the following town council minutes. The minutes of the regular meeting of November 23rd, 2021. Item 4C, liquor license application. Consideration and possible action to recommend approval of the Arizona Department of Liquor License and Control application for a Series 6 liquor license bar for the Quartzsite Yacht Club located at 1090 West Main, Quartzsite, Arizona, 85346. These three items are all on the consent agenda. Any item to be reviewed for separate discussion? Seeing none.
Mr. Mayor, I'll make a motion to approve the to adopt the consent agenda.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilmember Goldberg, seconded by Vice Mayor Warner, to approve the consent agenda. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries. Onto the business section, item number five, two national opioid litigation settlement agreements. Consideration and possible action to authorize the town manager to sign two national opioid litigation settlement agreements. The distributed settlement agreement with McKesson, AmerisourceBergen, and Cardinal, and the Janssen settlement agreement. Janssen Pharmaceuticals and its parent company, Johnson & Johnson.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. This item's been before you in the past, but the first step was we kind of said we're interested in participating. The second one was where we said, yes, in fact, we are interested. And now this is the third one saying, okay, we're ready to sign. I'm going to let Joe go ahead and give more detail. You've heard it before, but many of the public have not, so.
Mayor and Council, again, this is the final stage of the multi-stage process to acknowledge the town's approval of the two national opioid settlement agreements. There are multiple other cases that are pending on a national basis, but these are the two main cases that will ultimately result in a net distribution throughout the entire country of approximately $26 billion to resolve the claims and allegations with regard to the opioid epidemic and the over-prescribing of opioid pain medication. The state has taken the lead role, the main role, in negotiating these settlements on behalf of the entities in Arizona. We've signed and approved the One Arizona Plan, which is the distribution agreement between the state and the municipalities and counties on how the funds that are received are going to be distributed on a percentage basis. And these two agreements are the actual settlement agreements for the two main litigation cases. I wish I could tell you that by signing these agreements, you're going to get X amount of dollars next year and be able to tell you exactly what the town's going to receive out of these agreements. But because the ultimate settlement and the ultimate amounts are based off of a critical mass of municipalities throughout the entire country signing off on these agreements. So you can imagine there's these discussions happening all over the country right now. With, I anticipate, the vast majority of them agreeing to it because it's a take-it-or-leave-it proposition. You either agree to the settlement agreements and you will get some of the funds out of those agreements, or you don't and you don't get any funds because we're not a party to the litigation other than being a class party. We're not an active litigant in the litigation. So the way this works is ultimately the Janssen, the Johnson & Johnson settlement is approximately $6 billion, which is paid out over 9 years, and it's anticipated that that will be front-end loaded for the first 3 years to try to get as much of that up front. The distributor class settlement is approximately $20 billion for a total of $26 billion, and that is paid out over a period of 18 or 19 years. So the money's going to trickle in, and that money is restricted use money. It can't just go into the general fund. It has to be used for opioid programs, either the treatment of opioid addiction, education, additional funding for police education and equipment, Narcan, things like that, is what those funds can be used for. So ultimately, the town should receive a payment sometime next summer, approximately July or August. We don't know what amount that will be, and then essentially on an annual basis receive something towards the opioid issues to be used for those state purposes. And this is to authorize the mayor, town manager, to sign off on the agreements and return those to the national administrators of the case so that they can keep track. And we have a deadline of January 2nd to sign off on that.
Questions?
How will these monies be held then by the town?
They will be in the general fund, but they will have to be spent on certain items based upon the settlement.
And we are obliged then to come up with a program that would fit?
Yes.
Do you see any of these funds?
And since their settlement after budget has been already approved, they're likely going to sit until you have your new budget anyway.
Anyone else?
I'd like to make a motion.
We have to, process here, we need to go by. This is marked invitation to public comment, do I have any members of the public that can speak? Saying none, we'll close public comment, bring it back for any final council discussion, so then.
And we can go through all 800 pages of the agreement if you'd like.
Can we do that next meeting?
Say that for two Saturdays from now.
I just wanted to make a small comment, and it's in response to what Carrie was asking. When you have a state or a fund like that, what happens is there's a separate general ledger number that's kept in the general fund, and all of those monies go into that particular general ledger, into that general ledger account, so that it can be easily tracked. Even though the money is in the general fund, it's separated by that account number, so that you can keep track of how much came in and how much went out.
Can those funds be put in an interest-bearing account?
If we're going to invest them into Bitcoin?
They will be, as are all our funds. That term interest these days doesn't mean an awful lot to us, you know. We receive pennies now where we used to receive dollars. But yes, it will be in an interest-bearing account.
I suspect when monies are finally released, that there'll be additional instructions on the use of that money.
Yeah, and we have a list of what uses we're able to use it for. There will be some minor reporting requirements to be able to show that we used it appropriately. Again, I'm estimating somewhere around $44,000 over the period of the total distribution. That could be, you know, a few thousand dollars a year kind of thing. Not something that would even bear a ton of interest. But even at that, there are state statutes, just for council's edification, that limit the types of investments that towns and cities can place their funds into. And interest-bearing accounts are one of those. They just don't accumulate very much interest. But a little still more than zero.
Any final questions?
I would like to make a motion to authorize the town manager to sign the distributor and Jensen settlement agreements.
We have a motion by Councilmember Hamer, seconded by Vice Mayor Warner, to sign the agreement for the settlement to allow the town manager to sign those two litigation settlement agreements. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries. On to item six, Willdan Financial Services proposal for professional services on water and wastewater rate analysis.
Thank you, Mayor and council members. I'm going to give a little bit of an explanation. We have a number of our citizens here tonight that may not know all the process that we go through. Water and wastewater funds are what we call enterprise funds. They're not general fund. And I hear people all the time talk about running, you know, government like a business. Well, this is one of those areas where it's more like a business, even though I believe we always are trying to be very careful about our dollars, even in the general fund. But in the enterprise funds, what you've got to be careful about is you're not mixing dollars. You want the water account to pay for itself. You want the wastewater account to pay for itself. We didn't always do that here. There were a number of years back where, I don't know why sometimes, I know councils are concerned about raising rates, and so what they do is they borrow the money over here, and we did that, and that was wrong. And it cost us a lot of money, millions, literally, in our HERF funds. And we ended up having to pay that back because those dollars were legally not allowed to be transferred from HERF. These funds, these accounts should pay for themselves. So 5 years ago, you as a council, not all of you, but the council, made a decision to put our water and our wastewater departments where they needed to be on an even keel. Not making a lot of money, but paying for things. And so we had a study done. And we've been following that study. We did a 5-year plan. And now it's time to do another 5-year plan. We want to continue to operate the way that we have and be able to pay our bills properly, especially our loans that were taken out, for example, for the wastewater treatment facility, to make sure we continue to provide a proper water supply for our public. And so it's time to do that study again. We were very fortunate to find that the individual who did the study last time is still available. And if you'll recall, when we budgeted this earlier in the year, knowing that this was our 5th year, we put in $40,000 for this study because we figured it cost $30,000 last time with inflation and everything else going on. We might need that $40,000. Well, as it turns out, because they have done ours before, they have a model that already has a lot of the information. And it's going to save us money. So it's only going to cost us $24,000. $12,000 of that will come out of the water fund, $12,000 of that out of the wastewater fund. It takes for this type of study normally 60 to 90 days. This one might go a little bit faster because, again, they've worked with us prior, and they've already submitted the list of things that we need to get to them, so we'll be able to move through this a little bit quicker. But in any case, you will have, before you get into your budget process, you will have the necessary information to decide what direction you'd like to go. We're not asking for a book. I think we provide you a book. That'll cost you about $5,000 more. But I know what happens with those books. They end up on a shelf somewhere, and we never refer to them anyway. What we will receive is all the same information, but we will receive it in a PowerPoint presentation, and that information then is you can slip it in a drawer, put it on your shelf, or whatever you want to do with it. We'll also have it in a CD format so that it's available, and we can even put it on our website. So I'm very happy that we were able to put this together with Will Dan, and I would ask for you to support this so we can move forward in the professional way that we have in the last 5 years.
Questions, comments?
You going to be using the census data for this?
No. No, we'll use the accurate account information that we have.
I just think we're really, really lucky that the person that did do the previous study is available. And I just want to comment on something you said when you talked about the money, the HERF money that was used, and how happy and proud this town should be that we were able to pay that back in 4 years.
Yep.
You know, and thank you, Mr. Ferguson and council, for working to get that done.
And my comment would be that this is just another way that our town administration and town council work together to continue on the path that we have started 4 or 5 years ago when all these things were remedied. We're continuing to not make remedies, but stay on the path to keep our financial package in good working order. And I think using Willdan again with the things they're allowing for us because they worked for us before is another one of those financial pluses. Thank you.
Any other questions before we open this to public comment? Okay, no other public comment, we'll close public comment, bring it back during the final council discussion. I'd like to comment myself with an additional payback to HERF funds from this last few years. We also rebuilt a whole wastewater treatment plant. Since then, we've also added a new well and a number of improvements along with this. Also, this is run similar to a business, but similar to a nonprofit business, not a for-profit business. So, clarify that as much as we can project the actual cost over the next 5 years and incremental increases and such. So, with just bare bones, keeping it right to pay expenses. Anyone else in final comments? Okay, this is an action item.
I make a motion to approve the engagement letter with Willdan Financial Services proposal for water and wastewater rate analysis to have Jim Ferguson, town manager, approve to sign the letter.
Second. We have a motion by Vice Mayor Warner, seconded by Councilmember Hsu to approve the engagement letter with Willdan Financial Services proposal for water and wastewater rate analysis and Jim Ferguson, town manager, approval to sign the letter. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries. Item number 7. Quartzsite Area Chamber of Commerce and Tourism seeks temporary road closure for Hyde Jolly Daze Parade. Consider approval for the Town Public Works Department in cooperation with the Town Police Department to close Tyson at Central and Plymouth at Quail Trail for the Hyde Jolly Daze Parade, January 8th, 2022. And you know, do we have a presenter on that?
Hey, Johnson Thurries. I'm part of the Quartzsite Chamber of Commerce. I want to thank the town for helping us make the Santa Claus Parade, Christmas Parade, a huge success. And I'd like to ask for your help to do the same thing for the Hyde Jolly Parade, January 8th. We're going to use basically the same route, except we're going to be stopping at the dance lot in the town park. We'd like to get permission to close the road the same way as we did before, and we'll be using similar volunteers, the same volunteers, to make everything run smoothly.
What time is it scheduled for?
It's lines at 10:30 and starts at 11:30. 11:30, the parade starts, line up at 10:30.
The volunteers, the radio, the amateur radio club that did the staging, helped with the staging, did a really great job. The comments that I heard, and this is something that I think we need to work on, is we need to keep it together.
Yeah.
I had people tell me that they left, they thought it was over, that the Christmas parade was over, and then all of a sudden, here came some more. So if there's some way that we can get them going and try to keep people together rather than having great big distances.
Yeah, that was the only thing I noticed, the main problem I noticed, is when I talked to the person that was supervising them that night, of the Christmas parade, saying we need to put them closer together for the next one.
But otherwise, they did a great job. They were really pleasant, you know, easy to work with.
Actually, I have several concerns. Christmas parade was good because of the desert image radio club. They handled the traffic, and I see this is basically the same thing. Meet at the fire station. Well, that happened then. And what happens is vehicles go zooming by the staging area, and it's a dangerous situation.
Yeah, we've already made some updates to the flyer.
I don't have that information.
Yeah, so it's updated. We've changed meet at the fire station to starting east of the Tyson, or the Quartzsite Medical Clinic, and ending at the town park. So we've changed that because when we approved the meeting, we somehow missed a few details of that flyer. And so that is... That those instructions are to the people that will be watching the parade. So,
well, how are they going to get by the staging area?
Last time, basically, left the roads open until the start of the parade.
It was still a dangerous situation.
And actually, last time we lined them up on the side of. On the shoulder of the road, and also on the, and then we had overflow on the right lane, so there was a way for them to get by if they came through Tyson Street.
I saw several people almost get hit, so I'm sorry if I don't think it's a safe situation.
So that'd be something we could talk to the ham radio club about then.
Also, the Camel Corps never came into Quartzsite, and the military was never in Quartzsite with camels. And you're trying to bend history with this fire. So this is not a historic thing. Are the live camels going to walk, or are they going to ride? It says here the riding.
Yeah, no, we changed out the striding down the road.
And will there be somebody to pick up their deposits?
Yeah, we need to make sure that happens.
The company that brings the camels is going to take care of all
that. Take care of that. Okay. Yeah.
I'm just going by the information I have. And one thing I'm really curious about, live food. What kind of live food are you going to have? I know what it means to me. It means like the Klingons, they have the porridge with the worms and stuff, and the Orient, they have monkeys, they have smoke. So what kind of live food are you going to have?
That's another thing we missed when we approved it. I talked to the person that had worked on the flyer and discussed that, and we talked to him again tomorrow about it. He thought that was common way to put it. I think it would be better live musician for the song itself. So we could submit an updated one.
You can't submit an updated one because we're not going to have another council meeting.
Well, all we're approving
is the route. And the route I deem is unsafe.
Anyone else?
I'm going to ask the chief. Chief, do you feel that... Is that okay?
Sure. We can ask the chief.
Is there a comment that you want to make on the safety, the route, or whatever?
Mayor and Council, the route that's presented, it's probably the best route that we have for in town. And it's better than being out on 95. It's better than being out on Main or even Central. It's the easiest for us to control.
So
now getting ADOT approval to shut down roads, there's a lot of difficulties can do it on other roads and other than roads that we can do.
So basically, it's just that the concerns, the safety concerns would be working with your volunteer group is what it sounds like, as far as making sure we don't have traffic.
Yes, we can. We could, I mean, the roads could be shut down, could be shut down a lot sooner where, well, the problem lies, because everybody can be parking on the shoulders on the net, so they could watch the parade. And the only way for us to allow the public is allow them to continue to use that and keep it open so they can park.
Right.
If they close it down at the last minute and give it time before we go that everything's been cleared. That's one way that we could allow the public to park and see the parade.
Would it be possible to close, like right at the fire station at Tyson and Central, and then close that section there and have everybody go around the other way to do their parking rather than having them going by the
fire station?
The fire station and all the floats and whatever.
Well, part of the problem is that when you allow people to come back up on Plymouth and park, you're going to have individuals who are going to continue to go up and turn on the Tyson, and you're still going to run into the same situation.
If we barricade there at the bend.
At Tyson?
Yeah. And then the floats and the parade can come down Tyson and stage in front, you know, past the fire station. But anybody wanting to come up Plymouth to watch can still get up there. They just can't go any further.
Yes, that's feasible.
Johnson, that works?
Yeah, I like that idea because we're going to be parking the floats on the right side anyways. So if someone were to come up Plymouth and want to exit on Tyson, they could get by. But if we stop the traffic coming, you know, past the fire station on Tyson, then that would, that seems like that.
The only people that can go down Tyson would be the entrance in the parade.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Works for me.
Anyone else?
Okay.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you, Council.
We'll open this item for public comment. Do we have anyone who wants to speak on this? Okay, we'll close public comment.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Johnson.
I'm counsel for this item. This is action item.
I make a motion to approve the temporary closure of Tyson at Central and Plymouth at Coyle Trail for the High Jolly Daze Parade on January 8, 2022.
I'll second.
We have a motion by Vice Mayor Warner, seconded by Councilmember Goldberg, to approve the temporary closure of Tyson and Central and Plymouth at Coyle Trail for the High Jolly Daze Parade January 8, 2022. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries. Item number 8, council approval for the Quartzsite Transit Department to submit application for funding. Discussion, consideration, and possible approval for the Transit Department to apply to the Arizona Department of Transportation for federal funding in the preliminary amount of $272,223. Aye.
Good evening again, Mayor and Council, and Fire Transit Department. Do you have any questions about the budget that you have in your package? So, back in February of 2020, started the CARES Act, or the Coronavirus Relief and Economic Security Act. And that funding started with $203,000 for us. So we have built that down over the last 21 months. Our current balance with our CARES Act funding is $219. And this reflects billing to ADOT through November of 2021. So I'm anticipating using up a good deal of this $13,000 when I bill them for the month of December. And after that, CARES Act funding will be done, and we will go back to the funding where we have a federal share and a local general fund share.
Any questions for Jan?
No.
Any discussion?
This is just for the, this is just for the grant. Right, so you guys can write for, apply for the grant, right? Okay.
Okay, this is marked for an invitation for public comment. See no one who has applied to speak on that from the public. Close public comment, bring it back for any final council discussion.
Well, we are, this is a preliminary transit budget that she's asking us to approve first. Oh, okay.
That would be my next.
I see.
We kind of got that a little bit confused, I think it was just described, but what we need first is to be able to make the, approve the application. And then, if that's approved, then the budget is set.
Gotcha.
Any questions on that? Okay, action item.
I'll make a motion to approve the Transit Department to apply to the Arizona Department of Transportation for federal funding in the amount of $272,223.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilmember Goldberg, seconded by Vice Mayor Warner, to approve the Transit Department to apply for the Arizona Department of Transportation for federal funding in the amount of $272,223. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries. On to item 9. Approval of the preliminary transit budget for federal fiscal year 2022-2023. Discussion, considerations, and possible action to approve the preliminary transit budget for federal fiscal years 2022 through 2023.
So, Mayor and Council, your expenses for this preliminary budget will be the 272-223. So you also have two sources of income that come from the Transit Department to offset the budget. So one of those sources of income is the passenger paid fares. So last year, we took in $3,860.50 in passenger paid fares. The other income that offsets the budget is our grant with WACOG. So our last year's grant with WACOG took in $12,971, providing 763 free rides. So the total income that will offset the, or that offset the budget last year was $16,831.50. So we will also have both of those categories of income on this budget as well.
Any questions?
It doesn't offset, it helps with the match, right?
$90,000. And that money comes in to offset the $90,000. And is there any other grants that you can get to help offset that?
Not that I'm aware of. And we do have to be careful because sometimes we are limited by ADOT as to what we can apply for.
Because I don't know if the public understands that because of the census, we're going to be short. And $90,000 out of the general fund is a big chunk. So I'm really concerned about that.
Anyone else?
What happens if you don't get the grant?
Well, we never know from year to year how much Congress is going to give FTA to distribute for ADOT. So you can ask for and submit all you want how much funds they receive and they have to distribute is a different story. So what you do is you rewrite your budget, that's why this is preliminary, with what you are receiving and how you're going to proceed. So you...
If you don't get the grant, what happens?
What happens is you rewrite your budget down to bare bones, you put no extra things in it, and you will be using the town's general fund to support the transit department.
And how much is that a year?
Well, look.
If the town had to support the transit by itself, what would it cost?
How much is your budget?
Well, the proposed budget is $272,000, but you would look at wherever you could cut corners and you would have a more reduced budget to move forward on.
So because of our potential shortfall, why haven't we already done that?
We have considerably cut the current operating budget.
Mayor, members of council, since COVID started, Quartzsite Transit has dramatically cut back its services. We haven't gone to Yuma, we haven't gone to Havasu. For the last 2 years, we've dramatically cut back our services using the existing monies available. If ADOT, for whatever reason, chooses to not continue to fund us at these current rates, then we have it's just a real simple choice, just simple math. If we want to provide the same lower level of service that we've been doing for the last 2 years, we either make it up a town general fund or we cut the service. It's just real simple.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. Let's open this up for public comment. David, do you have anyone? Okay, we'll close public comment. We'll get back to any final council discussion or questions.
I make a motion that we approve the preliminary transit budget for federal fiscal year
2022 to 2023. Thank you, Mayor and Council. Okay, the motion was to approve the preliminary transit budget for federal fiscal year 2022-2023. Okay. I don't know how to say that. Okay, we have a motion by Council Member Chu, seconded by Council Member Heyman. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries. I Item number 10, adjourn to executive session. An executive session pursuant to Arizona Revised Statute 38-431.038(3) for discussion or consultation with town attorney for legal advice to the common council concerning an appointment to the council and pursuant to Arizona Revised Statute 38-431.038(1) for discussion or consideration of applicants for possible appointment to the common council. And the names discussed would be Al Davidson.
Mayor, if I could, just real quick, pursuant to our conversation, we're just going to go into executive session pursuant to ARS 431.038(3). So we're not going to discuss any individuals.
Okay.
So we don't need to list those. We're just going to go in for legal advice as to the process and then we come back out and.
Okay. So we're looking for a motion to adjourn to executive session.
I'll make a motion to adjourn to executive session.
Yes.
We have a motion by Councilmember Goldberg, seconded by Vice Mayor Warner, to adjourn to executive session. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries, we adjourn to executive session. Sound check, can you hear me back here?
Yes.
Testing.
Okay, we're returning to open session. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Mayor Simpson.
Here.
Vice Mayor Warner.
Here.
Councilmember Bearcat.
Present.
Councilmember Stevens.
Here.
Councilmember Goldberg.
Here.
Councilmember Allen.
Present.
Okay, we need to adjourn the executive session.
I'll make a motion to adjourn executive session.
Second.
We have a motion to adjourn the executive session made by Councilmember Goldberg, seconded by Vice Mayor Warner. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Okay, motion carries. Executive session is adjourned. Jim?
Yes, Mayor, councilmembers, it's okay with you, all due respect, I have an announcement to make to the public on your behalf. First of all, let me remind everybody here that the council is required to make their decisions in a meeting. They can't talk behind closed doors about those kinds of things. And those decisions have also to do with procedure. And tonight, the council's had the opportunity to talk about some of the issues that are important to them and to hear from the town attorney some of the procedural things that are important in the process of making an appointment. Let me also say that the council is extremely pleased with the amount of interest for this position. It's a very nice thing to see. We haven't always seen that here in Quartzsite. And so just simply the fact that we have seven people that are interested in serving is of, well, it's just a very nice thing. And so I want to say that. What the council is has decided is that with this much interest, it's important that they take the time in the interviews that's necessary. And to continue with that tonight, probably we'd be here till 3 o'clock. We don't want to do that to you, nor do we want the council to have to get out the pajamas, you know. So what they decided to do is to have a special session on January the 15th. That's a Saturday. It'll be starting at 9:30, and it will be held in the chambers here, if I remember correctly. And each of the candidates then will have more than adequate time to speak with the council. It's some questions will be developed so that every candidate will be asked essentially the same questions, and by that time we should be fine. We would do it sooner, and it is important. We know that it's very important for everybody. But with the holidays, we just felt it would probably be better to hold it after the first of the year. And this date is one that fits all of us. We hope it fits all of the candidates. If there is some reason why that just absolutely is impossible for a candidate to make, we'd like to know that as soon as possible. So if necessary, maybe we can do something different. I think that probably covers pretty much everything. Was there any other point that I missed? I think that that's pretty much everything. If anybody has any questions as to process from there, you're more than happy to help you with the concerns.
Just one quick question. When we do come back, will it be an executive session?
Thank you very much, Hal. Good question, because I should have said that. All of the interviews at that point will be in public. Okay, it'll be a totally open meeting where all the candidates will be asked basically the same questions. There's always the possibility of a follow-up question. The attorney and I will probably be asking each of you some very basic things to make sure that you're fully qualified applicants. They're very simple. They're statutory issues. That's all. There were some applications that didn't have all the blanks filled, and we need to make sure those blanks are filled. You know, so that's important too. We want to make sure that everybody's got that opportunity to answer those questions thoroughly for us. Okay.
Do we have an announced time and date?
Yep, January 15th.
January 15th.
9:30, that's a Saturday. Okay.
I would just like to know, will the public be able to give input at that meeting as well?
It will be a public meeting, but there won't be questions or answers from the public.
No, I mean, in the same way that on tonight's agenda, it was open for public comment, will it be open for public comment on that day?
I'd say
no.
These are interviews with candidates.
Okay, yeah, the one tonight was set the way it was because it was an executive session, and we assume there may be some questions from the audience because of that, but in this case, you will hear everything because it'll be a totally open meeting and open interviews.
So my question is, after the openly public interviews, will there be any opportunity at all? And if not, why? Why would there not be?
Because it's not your decision, it's ours.
It's an interview. We're interviewing the candidates.
And essentially, the public, you all have the opportunity to contact and ask questions of these individuals prior to that time to get to know them as well. But ultimately, it is the mayor and council are choosing who the replacement's going to be. So if you have questions or concerns of the candidates, you're more than welcome to contact them prior to that time. But the purpose for the meeting and the purpose for the questions and for the process is so that the mayor and council can gather and get sufficient information to make an educated decision as to who they're going to choose to fill this vacancy, which the vacancy is appointed to the next election, which the primary would be in August of 2022. And then if no one wins in the primary, then the general in November of 2022.
Okay, my question is, on the agenda, coming back from your executive session, it was right on there, invitation for public comment.
Right, and that's because you'll see that's on just about every one of our line items for our agenda items, introduction of item, council discussion, and invitation for public comment. So that was on there for tonight. It was inadvertent. This process is not a process where the council interviews and then there's public comment from the public as to the individual applicants. This is a council decision. So when it is agendized for the special meeting, it will be agendized as introduction of the item, council discussion, final council discussion, council action or direction. Thank you.
Before in the past, when we had these situations come up, when I was on the council, the interviews were done in executive session, and now they're not going to be. Why the change?
Well, a couple of our applicants asked to be interviewed in public. That changed the process.
But I was under the impression that more people said they wanted an executive session than sitting in public.
We also had an outstanding number of applicants this time. We've never had 7 applicants at one time. We've always been able to have more time to spend more time with each applicant if we had 1 or 2 or 3 applicants. But now this is a whole new process. To do 7 of them in the same day, we're looking at extending the time where we can spend the time necessary to give each candidate a fair opportunity to answer questions.
Okay.
So we can make an educated choice of who we select. We open up a lot of things and ask for public input, but the law is set where you're allowed the right to observe everything we do, but not necessarily participate in everything we do. Council selection is one of those things where we make the selection. The public can observe that, but not participate. Is it properly said, Joe?
Yeah, absolutely. And according to state statute in the law, the council could choose to have these council meetings, and every agenda item could be done without any invitation or call to the public. And there's not even a requirement that there be a call to the public at the beginning of the meeting. Those are accommodations that the council has chosen to have in these meetings so that they can have that public input and information. But just so the public's aware, it's not a requirement by state statute. And there are other municipalities that do not open up every agenda item to public comment or even have a call for the public.
Mayor, I want to clarify one thing also. I understand that somewhere in the past, interviews might have been done in an executive session, and they can be the choice of the council. But the council has, in fact, in more recent years, also had totally open interviews of council candidates. So it's not like this was all of a sudden a different thing than we've ever done before, because that's what you did last time.
Last couple.
Yes,
sir. Okay. Item 12,
13?
That's just so the record's clear. So we're going to reschedule the applicants, and if the mayor wants to call for, if someone wants to make a motion, then we have a special meeting for January 15th at 9:30 to interview the applicants. That would be appropriate as well for that.
I'll make a motion that we adjourn to January 15th at 9:30 a.m. Reschedule for interviews of applicants for the vacant seat on the town council.
Second.
And that was at 9:30?
9:30 a.m.
Dina, did you have the wording on that?
Yeah.
Okay, can you read that back to us?
No, I was going to use recording, I'm sorry.
Oh.
I made a motion to reschedule interviews of applicants for the vacant town council seat on January 15th at 9:30 a.m. in the council chambers.
And then, do we have a second on that? Okay, we have a motion by Councilmember Goldberg to reschedule interviews with candidates for the council position. Move that date to January 15th. 2022 at 9:30 a.m. in the council chambers.
Correct.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries.
And I just want to say thank you to all of you for being here tonight and for understanding how important this decision is for the town of Quartzsite. We want to do it the right way.
I have one more really quick question. When we do come before you, will we be allowed to give opening statements?
There will be a time limit, so if you choose to use your time limit for an opening statement, I don't see why. But everyone will be given the same amount of time.
I had a very short one.
How much time? We're going to be politicians, an hour?
And a half.
I think the council would like to try to keep the interviews down to about a half hour per individual.
Thank you.
It's not our intent to run the clock on you, you know, by any means, but we would hope that in the 30 minutes we could get through the questions. And that's why we're going to have some preliminary questions for you from the attorney and myself that they wanted to clarify.
And it's just so everybody knows the process, it's anticipated that there'll be the preliminary questions and there'll be six questions from the mayor and council. And those questions will be the same questions for each individual so that and we can try to get through that process in a half hour for each individual.
Okay, we still have,
and there's no need for item number 12 since there's no appointment, so we can jump to item number 13.
But we certainly do appreciate the magistrate being here.
I was just going to say.
Set the work session date, time, place for discussion of restructuring procedures and training for advisory boards.
We knew that you were looking for another work session. This item is one that we've had some good discussions with you on. We've been pulling together information. We put it here to see whether or not you want to have another work session to talk about some of the issues. For example, there was the discussion of the planning and zoning perhaps being a 5-member instead of a 7-member. And if you want to have further discussion on that, then we need to set a date for that. I don't really believe that we can get that all done in the council meeting. If, on the other hand, you'd rather us bring this item back to you with an either or, you know, kind of an approach to it, we could probably be ready first meeting in January to cover that for you. So, what's your pleasure?
Regarding that agenda item for the council, for the P&amp;Z planning and zoning?
Well, no, well, this, it's broader than that, but it did include the planning and zoning.
Advisory boards.
So the issue was the process of selection and that sort of thing, and we want to make sure we're all on the same page when it comes to the selection process, especially if you're going to change from a, you know, 7-member to a 5-member, for example.
Would be nice to have a 7-member council before we do this.
I would agree, given the change tonight in the process. I would agree that taking a little more time is probably a good thing. And let's do it right, let's have thorough input, you know, from everybody. Are we okay with that then? We'll just hold off on this and to get our other council members seated, and then we'll arrange to get it back to you. Okay.
Move on to item 14. COVID-19 protection measures for the town facilities, discussion and direction to staff concerning possible changes to COVID-19 protection procedures in town facilities.
Yes, Mayor and council members, some of the audience again this evening is not aware that we've had this on all of our agendas so that we can monitor and see what's going on. We're not trying to scare anybody. We're not trying to say that we know we have all the answers, but we're trying to monitor what's going on outside of town hall and inside town hall. And just so everyone knows, we have had some cases here in town hall. Just this last week, we had two individuals test positive for COVID. That is concerning to us, that happened in a very short time. We don't have a large staff. If you lose two people in one department, which we did for a week or a week and a half, that hurts. That really hurts. We've had three individuals in the police department, and fortunately at this point in time everybody's getting better, you know, but we want to make sure that we keep it safe. So we did reinstate the mask wearing in the administrative offices of town hall for a period of time to make sure that we're on top of it and that we don't have more cases popping up. At the same time, the council has taken a position of being a little freer with the wearing of masks in town hall. Many of you know, our librarian, Billy, did have COVID and she tested positive. It wasn't a matter of, you know, she had something else. She tested positive and she was out for quite some time and finally decided that she would retire because she just doesn't have the strength to return yet today, 2 months later. We've had another individual who is quite concerned about the fact that the town hall environment is rather open, and so they resigned as of this morning. So once again, it does put us in a position of saying, how do we best protect our employees and at the same time allow the freedom that many of our citizens want to have in terms of utilizing our facilities. And that's why you've chosen to look at this each meeting. As far as the statistics go, there has been a bit of an uptick here in the county. The state has had an increase again. The new variant is, as we understand it, is much more contagious, but appears to be a lot weaker in the sense that it's not creating as many problems for people, especially as we're told. Again, it's not our words. The CDC is saying that, especially amongst the vaccinated, there's a lot less problems. We're not making any decisions on that stuff. We've been following CDC guidelines, state guidelines, etc. But we've also been given the authority of the council to make judgments such as whether or not we feel masks need to be worn in the public facilities. And so I share that with you. I share it so that the public understands what you've been trying to do to watch this. And, but the statistics themselves, there's not enough to say where it's going, except it is going up a little. There's no doubt about it, it is going up a little. And we've got our cases around town. We've got one of our operations, nonprofits, that's closed because they had such a serious outbreak amongst their staff. And that concerns us. We did a very important organization to this town. And they had to make a decision to protect their people and others and close their doors for a period of time. So, but our decision's here. Our responsibility's here.
So we didn't have anything to do with that closing of that church?
We certainly did not. I don't know where, but the council got a communication today with somebody misunderstanding why an organization closed its doors last week, and they felt that it was the council that it did it. Council has nothing to do, no authority to actually go in and close a business down. You know, that's just, we don't even understand where that came from. But
it was anonymous.
Yeah, it was. It was anonymous. We have no way to respond to those kinds of things with the individual to help them understand that. And I know you don't even want that kind of authority. You know?
No.
And you certainly don't have it. But in terms of town, you know, and our buildings, the only authority lies with you, except for the administrative offices where I've chosen for a while to go back to our standard. And so that everybody understands, our employees do not have to wear their masks when they're sitting at their desk. They don't have to do that. But if they're out and about, they're visiting for the public, or they're even going into somebody else's office, and they're going to be in there for any period of time, we've asked that they protect themselves and the others. That practice broke down a little bit. Two people got sick. We got to be careful. I want to protect the health of the employees and make sure that they're okay. Nobody's requiring vaccinations or anything like that. We're not going to go there. But I do want to make sure that they're protecting each other.
What is our policy right now, or what is the after school, the kids? Are they being required to wear masks?
We have not initiated that ourselves because, again, when the council made the decision that they would not be requiring that in the open areas, public
right.
areas.
Right.
We've stayed away from that.
Okay.
Okay. Only the administrative offices have made any decision.
And right now, as it stands, there's no mandates from the governor, no CDC guidelines, no local mandates to wear masks or to do anything other than we've been doing for months. You're responsible for taking care of yourself. We're taking care of the employees here at Town Hall. I don't think we have any interest in any mandates unless it comes down from the governor's office or somewhere else. So we've been doing good, we were doing excellent, and now we have a lot of our winter visitors coming back, and that where it appears the upsurge is coming from is the winter visitors bringing in. Hopefully we'll all be okay if we just pay attention, do just what we've been doing, our social distancing and whatever you do at home. Is there any, without objection, is that the way we're leaving it? Is anyone got any other?
I believe it the way it is. I'd like to see master party in the library, because that seems to be a very concentrated spot, just like on the buses.
That's within the town facilities, isn't it?
Well, you could pick certain ones if you so chose, and thank you for mentioning that. It is still required on the transit, on the buses, and that is actually a federal requirement for the transit services, ADOT, because they essentially hold the purse strings, and they're saying, if you want our money, you will abide by this standard. So we are doing that. So thank you for reminding us on that.
And I kind of agree that in the library, because it is a more confined area, and right now, as you mentioned, Mayor, there's a lot of our winter visitors are coming in, and they utilize that library.
It's virtually impossible to social distance in the library. Yeah. It really is. And especially in January, that is going to be the most widely used library I've ever seen. For a town this size, I mean, that library gets extremely busy, you know. And it already is, by the way. It already is seeing a lot of people every day.
This is one of the items that we marked for invitation for public comment. Is there anyone that wishes to speak on the COVID and the closing?
Can
Sorry.
I say something?
Certainly.
Marilyn McFaith. I don't know if you guys know Mickey Whitcomb Britton, but she passed away Friday from the flu. So it's in Quartzsite. The doctor told me yesterday.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, we'll close public comment. Bring it back. Do you have enough direction, or does anyone have any additional comments? We're good with the way it is now.
I concur with the star that the library should be included in this.
Do we need a motion to what
we would need to be good. You made a motion previously to not do so. So I need something to reverse that.
Make a motion that the library is mandated to wear a mask when it goes in to utilize the library.
I'll second.
Hard decisions to make because our general public across our nation is divided on how we perceive dangers to ourselves and to others. However, I think in the town of Quartzsite we have been very open to the opposition to it and understanding why they hold those views. However, under the circumstances, when we have live COVID illness in the town facility, I believe it behooves us as a council to include the library in that, just to get back to the state we were at a month ago where we didn't find it necessary. Everything we do has to do with the health and safety of the town of Quartzsite. This is for the health and the safety of the town of Quartzsite and our government staff.
So the users of the library is mandated to wear a mask?
No, it goes in the library.
Okay. Anyone? So that the employees in.
Employees.
Anyone goes in. So we get this word. We have a motion by Councilmember Bearcat, seconded by Councilmember Goldberg, to mandate anyone who uses the library or works in the library is mandated to wear masks.
Motion.
Second, okay.
Yeah, oh yeah, I'm sorry.
All of us in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries. On to communications, item 15, report from the mayor. Already know COVID is up, so I won't go into that. Town is pretty busy. A lot of the RV parks are half full or more. We're finally getting workers in town. I finally filled with gut employees to where I can open the restaurant again. We're finally getting winter visitors that are applying for the jobs that we couldn't fill in the off season. So that's good. It's all coming. We're all getting prepared. Now my final reminder, there's only 10 more days till Christmas. Okay, reports from the council. Who's first?
I'll go.
First of all, ladies' luncheon we had last week. It was the first cold, miserable day in Quartzsite. We ended up only having 36 ladies, but again, I think we had two new ones last week. Wednesday, I am part of the La Paz Regional Tourism Team, and we were in Yuma. We were invited to be part of the Welcome Back Winter Bash in Yuma at the Civic Center. Many of you may have seen the display, the picture that we posted on Facebook. Even though the applicant was the tourism team, if you notice, all of the exhibit is Quartzsite. We did have Buck Connors, by the way. We did have brochures from all of the area, the county, Life, or Faust, Falling Valley, Parker. We had information on all of those areas. Talked to a lot of folks. They estimated the Yuma Sun is who puts that on, and they estimated between 2,000 and 2,500 attendees. And this was a very short window, 9 a.m. till 12:30. So we talked to a lot of people. A lot of interest in day trips, RV parks in Quartzsite. Are the restaurants open? Those kinds of questions. So I really expect to see a lot of those winter visitors that are in Yuma will be coming up to our area. The Yuma Sun also has decided that they're going to do an off-road expo in January in Yuma, and they have contacted our off-road folks here, Quartzsite Off-Road, and our off-road club. They are not getting a whole lot of cooperation in Yuma from the off-road groups regarding the Peace Trail. So we will be, as a matter of fact, I'm meeting with a couple of the folks from Yuma tomorrow,
they will be, we will be going down there to participate in that event in January. Again, promoting the Peace Trail and our brand new staging area here in Quartzsite. Friday, I'm going to be assisting Supervisor Irwin in Ehrenberg at the fire station, pictures with Santa, and the reason I'll be there is I'm going to be talking to parents and handing out flyers for the Salvation Army's event on Saturday, which our police department and a number of other volunteers get involved, where they bring the kids in and the kids get to shop without the parents. Leanne also mentioned that they've been very, very busy, but they still have some names on the angel tree. She asked me to mention that. I want to share something, and Chief Romo, you will be interested in hearing this. This morning when I was getting a cup of coffee, a gentleman called me, acknowledged you're on the town council. I just want to share something about your police department. And there was an incident out in the long-term camp area where a gentleman was, his RV was being broken into at 2 a.m. The person got up, went outside, was attacked by the perps, a dog, and I mean, the guy showed me his side, and the dog really did a number on him. He was stupid enough, he ran. Our police officer, and I don't know who was on duty, he couldn't remember the name, and the sheriff's department responded, as did fire and an ambulance. The guy was crazy enough to walk back to the campsite with the police standing right there, and he was able to identify, and we took him into custody, but the victim just praised the professionalism, the way our officer approached the perpetrator in a very professional, not a nasty way, but just nothing but high praise for the way our police department handled it. This guy was loud enough to where somebody in the other part of the shop heard. And when I was walking out, he said, I want to tell you another story about your police department. And one of our officers stopped this gentleman. He's a snowbird. And he said that he didn't give me a ticket, but he said, you know, how much winter visitors mean to the town of Quartzsite. We're glad you're here, but you need to slow down. But again, a comment about how professional and how warm, if you will, our police officers made these folks, even though they were in the wrong field. So I just want to share that, Chief Romo, and for you all here too.
Thank you.
Anytime. That concludes me.
I guess me. I attended a WACOG meeting, and WACOG has a lot of programs. Town Hall has the list of the different programs they have for winterizing and help with rent and all kinds of things. And La Paz County is being underutilized. Yuma is getting the lion's share of stuff. But WACOG specifically asked that Paz County and in particular Quartzsite start utilizing the services of WACOG. They've got money. They want to spend it. So we just need the people to go and get it. And yeah, there's a lot of red tape, but that's government. there's a meeting. I'm in pretty quick here about housing for the homeless. And that's up in the Border Health office, I believe. There's a lot going on, and there's a lot of things people can get involved in to help the community, help themselves, help their neighbors. All you gotta do is ask around and look, and it's there. There's an old saying here in Quartzsite, if you're bored in Quartzsite, it's your own fault.
When's the ladies' luncheon?
First Tuesday of every month.
You know where it's from?
It sounds like a popular place for a single guy.
We don't, we allow them.
That's not true.
Well, no, we did allow, yes. Sam's waiting, he was there, and the chief was there.
Just identify as a woman that lady.
Oh.
Okay. Does that conclude council report?
Yep.
Okay, we'll move on to reports from the town manager.
Thank you, Mayor. The first thing I'd like to mention, I put down there a report that concerning the splash pad. The council will recall that, and we've had people from the audience in the past talk about whether or not we might get a splash pad down. Of course, you've been talking about that as a council for some time and put some, actually some money in the budget this year to be able to hopefully match the grant. The nice thing is, as we started talking with the state, we found out that we weren't going to need that matching money from our general fund. Furthermore, after meeting out in the field, we found out that there was more money available than we thought, and we could not only put together a splash pad, but also make some pretty significant improvements. And so you see up on the screen here, an improvement master plan for town of Quartzsite. I want to, first of all, thank Nikki and also Cliff for the very hard work that they put in to this improvement master plan for the park. It goes well beyond just the splash pad itself, but some really important improvements in their force. But the most exciting part is that they have a two-meeting process. The committee met last week. The board will meet this week. The committee last week approved all the applications. There were three in the category we were in, and they approved all those moving forward to the board. So we at least got the stamp of approval at that level, and when we and the 16th this week will be the board meeting itself. So it's exciting. We're keeping our fingers crossed, but at least we get through that first meeting with a good mark. I don't know if there's anything else you'd like to add, Cliff.
If you just want to, I can show a little more about it if you want to turn the TVs on.
I hear some yes and some no's, but it's the council that I get it.
Okay, this part here is the number one, that area of the box one there, that's the splash pad itself, the 2,500 square foot splash pad. Number four is a shade Ramada. Number three is a combination restroom operations center for the equipment for the splash pad. The yellow stars here are LED lights. We're going to have parking lot lighting and then site lighting as well. There's so this is all entirely no construction within this particular area. And there's a lot of other amenities that we're doing with the other existing playground equipment and shade screens. You go up to the north area, and we are putting in parking lot lighting in front of the dance slab and along adjacent to the dog park. That way it'll make it a lot safer during the summer months when we have our July 4th events. And then also we're going to put in a camp host site adjacent to the restroom there, because there is an existing septic tank there. There's existing power there. We'll put in a camp host site and during the winter months to help increase security and, of this entire area. So the that's all of the, and this actually down here, we're going to fence in the basketball court. These playground areas will have Nikki.
Surfacing.
Yes. What do you call it?
Surfacing.
Thank you.
And so you know, there's two different pools of money that they have available. One will match the other, and collectively, we're talking almost $1 million in a grant to make improvements at our park. So again, thank you for the work that the two of you have done on that. I'd like to also make a couple of announcements of positions that have been filled. Jose Martinez has been hired as our new code compliance officer, and the chief's been breaking him in. He knows where the coffee pot's at and everything. So we're on a roll there. I've appointed Kiki Tanawa as our deputy town manager, and we were very happy to make that arrangement. The county was trying to steal her away, and I won't say anything more about that, but we've kept her here, and she's done an excellent job for us. She'll continue in her role as finance director as well. So that's an exciting thing. The other thing is to make another point about the library. We did have an individual leave us. We do need people to apply for the position that's open in the library. And we can also use volunteers. Now, volunteers are not as easy as you might think. Because we work with children and that sort of thing, we can't always just have somebody walk in and say, I'd like to volunteer today. If you're interested, let us know, and we can walk you through the process as to what you need to do to volunteer. But we're always looking for people to help out. So please, if you know somebody, let them know about it. And that's all I had.
Okay, we'll move on to future agenda items.
I don't have any.
I think we'll have plenty. Yeah, we're going to have plenty.
Okay.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Ten more days till Christmas. Having no further business come before this council, we're going to have a dinner.
Thank you everybody for coming.
Be safe. Stay safe.